Well, that's a good question, whether, you know, what is a designer of educational environments? So firstly, I would like to thank you for this invitation. It's a real honor and a pleasure to be here to share in this environment, which is a kind of cross-cutting environment across technology and school practices. I think it's very interesting. We are at a time, well, I'm speaking from the perspective of education, because I'm a teacher and I focus on education and research. We need these synergies to be able to create implementation practices for technology in the classroom that will have educational value, that is deep, important, and that is built from the roots. So when I say the roots, I mean from the classrooms, from the pupils, the teaching staff, and the universities. So a whole set of factors which enable creativity to flourish in this biodiversity, so that we can see the nuances and the complexity and the long-lasting nature of these practices. What I'd like to share with you today are some ideas, some intuition, some concepts that I've been gathering over the past 5 years in these three contexts. One is a project which is called Aulab, and it is sponsored by the Asturias regional government. And it has a center of art and industrial creation. So it focuses a lot on research and the cross-section of arts and industrial creation. Recently, it's been used as a teaching information tool by the Education Board, with the idea of finding different ways of doing things, make it more participatory, and in terms of new technologies, it's a more achieving approach, more consistent approach. And gathering data and learning, a tool that I used is Fab Learn, and this is driven by the Stanford University. There are now 40 educational professionals around the world who are involved in this, and we try to implement the digital making in the classroom with educational value, and particularly focusing on methodology changes. Another very interesting area is applied technology in the Autonomous University of Barcelona, where I finished my PhD. And last but not least, from the north of Spain, San Sebastian. I'm working with a group of professors to write a best practices book on the implementation of think labs, STEM labs, in classrooms, in formal and informal contexts. So the objective of the research and the reason that brought me here was and is to define a learning environment for the teaching staff, which would bring together all the potential of these new technologies and the creative and critical use of technology. So what has been repeated through the presentations we've seen today is move away from a user mindset and move more to a creator's mindset and use of technology. So use that potential to then turn them into training actions for teaching staff based on reflection and on collective creation, collective knowledge creation. So disseminating best practices and allow them to flourish, always based on the stakeholders, the key stakeholders, so the teaching staff, the pupils, and the researchers. The methodology that we used is called design-based research. It's design-based research. It's very typical in technology design. So you start with the preliminary model and you design an artifact or a system, adapting it to the context where you want the implementation to happen. It is implemented. It is then analyzed, the findings and the impacts. And then it goes through several design cycles, however many are necessary, until we reach a format which can then be adapted to different contexts. What happens in this context? We adapt the design based on data that we collect, but we are also producing knowledge and theories on, for example, what is happening and why do certain things happen when these types of practices are implemented. Apart from the methodology, I would also like to share a little about what was driving us to do this. Why did we use the maker approach or the do-it-yourself approach as a way of supporting or criticizing technology? What are the reasons behind this? So the maker-centered education, what it requires or what it wants is for technology to be accessible, not just that it can be used, but really that the user can design his or her own technology or can design significant things with it. So we're interested in the educational model behind this. This is a model which is interest-based. I'm going to learn something because I'm interested in playing with that thing, or I like to create things. So I'm learning to use technology through play. I think that describes it quite well. And it's also a very horizontal approach. It has a horizontal learning approach, and it offers a positive attitude towards knowledge. You're not learning to win awards or to get good grades. You're learning because we get to choose what to learn. We need to learn certain things in order to create significant things for ourselves. And that really works with pupils. Another positive aspect is failure is promoted. Errors or failure are elements which allow us to continue to research, grow, and learn. The more times I fail or make mistakes, the more I learn. And finally, the fact that we can create and share, so the sharing part of the maker model. So in a scientific way, but in a more agile way, how can we work to create accessible knowledge and work from different disciplines? That's very important as well. Another concept behind this research is the figure of the teacher as a designer, or designing the environment, as we mentioned before. So this is an idea that came out of a study scope which is called design learning. And it's something very straightforward. It's based on, right now, the teacher should not be somebody who is just conveying and recycling information. Teachers need to manage a huge amount of data and information. And so it would be impossible for them to use traditional methods to convey that to pupils. So what's the idea here? The idea is to design environment, systems, materials, dynamics to generate a safe and stimulating space where people can learn on their own. And this does not mean that they're just left on their own, but rather it's a stimulating environment and which an environment which supports learning, but it's really interest-based. Learning design is a concept, a practice, and also a descriptive framework. So classroom practices can be shared. An interesting point here, for example, is the need to really work on this area. This all sounds wonderful, the experiences that you have presented here today. So how can we use them in another type of context without repeating them exactly the same and manage to transfer their essence? There's an interesting metaphor for this idea, is music sheets. So we want to practice innovative practices which allow us to learn and grow and introduce technology. If I do this, then that's great. But then if I want to do this in another context, what's the risk? The risk is if I do this in the same way, I go back to a situation of just repeating with sheets and guidelines. That would be like the traditional music sheets. And what if we were to change traditional musical notation for jazz? So I can recognize the melody from somebody else, even if the musician is interpreting it in their own way. The essence of that musical notation remains. And this is kind of the idea that we adopt with learning design. Another important part, so how can I train this designer, this teacher who seems like a superhero, that they need to have so many skills and be able to configure their workplace? One way of doing this is training them by involving them in co-design processes. That's what we've done, co-design of the workspace, co-design of the curriculum, co-design of materials. These can be artifacts as well. There's a lot of freedom there. This is a training methodology, which is called teacher design research. And the objective is to train non-expert teachers in a flexible way so that they can really take advantage of the resources they have. It's based on practical experience as the core element of creating innovation and best practices. So we need deep, continued participation in design processes, in implementation, concept, evaluation, in all the processes. It's also based on collaboration with the research world, which works in the classroom context directly to support the teacher and to co-design with the teacher some learning processes. And what do we see? Normally, if we apply this type of methodology, we generate innovations. We generate best practices. And there's a likelihood of disseminating them. And a more important point is that we manage to really have a deep impact on the teacher's beliefs. Often, the use of technology in classrooms is blocked by the technophobe attitudes or training problems or some fears or other reasons. However, this type of process and this approach will allow us to understand why those blocks exist and be able to act on them. And everyone is at the same level because this really is co-design. That's the most important point here. So this is learning designer. So this is kind of to answer the moderator's question from the beginning. So this is a type of teacher who basically focuses on designing environments, artifacts. When I say environment design, I mean maybe change the furniture around. You know, we're not needing to call NASA to help out with this. Quite often, we just need to act effectively, and we don't need huge resources for this. So design, which is based on the pupils or whatever objectives you might have, and often we work on the curriculum, not extensively, but rather focus in on one area of the curriculum and really get really deep into that area. So this requires time and also a specific design of the space. And of course, it's a learning designer because they need to be willing to learn, think about what's happening. They need to find solutions in other disciplines, particularly if they want to introduce technology. They need to resolve problems and design research processes in order to share this with others. So this is a teacher who has a teaching style which is very much a facilitator, it's not a direct teaching style, but rather somebody who facilitates the learning process. They don't see learning as something which is just about conveying information. Normally, it's more project-based or problem-solving-based learning, and they base their teaching on the process through observation, through documentation about what they do. In this experiential approach, we normally learn from our pupils via our pupils. And particularly, this is a teaching profile who inspires and stimulates. She can quite often foster curiosity and maybe be a troublemaker by looking for problems. And last but not least, again, this is a person who really documents processes, documents the knowledge, and via physical or digital platforms, connects with the different communities who are developing things. That's important, because the danger of all of this is that you can generate wonderful experiences, which then don't get further than the filing cupboard, or they're just on the school report, and they don't go any further. So this is important. As we'll see, this can be quite tough. Throughout the research, we detected several needs. We worked firstly with the teaching staff. We decided what we needed to implement, and then the professors, the teachers with the pupils in the digital creation lab, they would create a 9-month-long project, a project that would run throughout the whole year. So 30 or 40 groups have gone through this, and over this time, the data that we have collected are quite broad, but there are three areas. There's an emotional engagement in using this type of methodology and these types of tools. I think that 80% of my work over these years has been simply supporting, calming teachers down, explaining, physically and emotionally supporting the teachers. Because quite often you think, okay, this is a new tool, let's just introduce it into the classroom and everything will work fine. No, you need to create and feel comfortable with the new tools. The teaching staff is going through a period of uncertainty. There's a real, well, I think for the past 10 years, there's a new approach to the classroom, and this can create huge difficulties in terms of manage this in the classroom where everything is going so fast. You have to get down to work. You don't have any time. You need to present things. There's rivalries and, you know, the day-to-day work that you all experience. And I think quite often when things like this have been implemented, the emotional side or support hasn't been looked at. But what I've seen from the groups that I've worked, this has been a game changer. Because once you build trust and people feel comfortable and at ease with this type of working, then all doors are opened up. People really engage with the methodology. They use technology which they find the most appropriate. Another need which we have found has been the teaching staff's expectations. The most common approach was just short courses. I'll go as a teacher on a short course on a new tool or a new software. They'll tell me how it works, more or less. I'll use it. and then I'll be given some guidelines on how to implement it in the classroom. So you have a 30, 40-hour short course, and then I find myself back in the classroom, and I have to start to integrate this with my pupils and all the problems that might entail. What has happened is this type of training has kind of elapsed now. It's passive. Of course, it's necessary. Of course, we need that type of information, but it's not change-making training unless the person really gets involved and really gets into that area. So the problem when training a teacher as a designer is you need to have this mindset for self-learning, for resource, being resourceful, accessing research, not just expecting to receive a sheet of this is what I need to do, and then I can just apply this as is in the classroom. Another really important part is, well, once again, documentation, which is an area, it's like one of the core problems, one of the pain points, is that there's no documentation culture. Quite often we confuse documentation with assessment, assessment with skills, or documentation is seen as control by the school management. Quite often, what we see is documents are produced, they're put on a bookshelf, and they're left there. We need to work on best practices that are smart, attractive, and fast. It shouldn't feel like a burden. Documentation that could be carried out on a daily basis and which can be used to implement these practices in other contexts. So, to work on this type of training need, we have considered changing the design of the program and structure it in three stages. Firstly, one will be the initiation, so any fears, any technophobes, any attitudes that need to be addressed. So look at a fun way of using the technology. So to try to create the attitude of, I can do this. I'm a primary school teacher. The first circuit that I soldered in my Arduino system, well, I really enjoyed it and I continue to work on this. And this gateway is really important. This is the first entry point. Otherwise, the fears will remain. And next, we need to look at training in action. So the pupils and the teachers come together in the lab, and we work all together. And what can be done there? There, they can see a different way of working, and they might just remain as observers. But quite often when they see this more experiential way of working and this context where lots of things are being created, pupils, for example, pupils who struggle in class because they're more interactive or they don't react to traditional methods, when they get to the lab, they're the ones who really get stuck in and have more fun. They really enjoy what they're doing. And then sometimes the teachers look at them and think, but that guy, he's awful in class, and now I see how well he's doing here. Or, you know, they see them working as well as a pupil who's a high achiever in another environment. So this allows a space to observe this type of things. And also to move away from having to control the classroom. And it's not a problem stepping away from controlling the classroom. This can work. You know, if you look at
educational making that might seem chaotic. People are doing things all over the places. Maybe there's kids sitting on the floor, or visually this doesn't look very orthodox. You know, it's not a case of 25 pupils staring at me while I speak. Rather, there are little groups of people all doing their own thing. This type of experience allows the teacher to say, OK, this chaos might be a bit shocking, but normally we tend to see that they are convinced. We convince them without having to use words. They see what's happening. It's like magic, or that's how I see it. And then the third stage in this format, which is the most utopian, so to speak, is introducing education labs in the schools. So what do I mean by labs? Spaces where technology can be learned. There's knowledge exchange among the same teaching staff of one school. So working through trial and error. And after all these years of work, and knowing that today, in today's audience, there's a lot of head teachers, I would like to take this chance to pose this question. I have some hypotheses. I have some ideas of how we can foster this experimental, open, creative attitude in the teaching staff by the management team, because quite often the teachers activate this and they react well to these practices and they want to implement it, and they ask for support from their management teams. And quite often support is confused with, well, they're asking for resources or equipment or bigger spaces. But from our experience, this is more flexibility that they're asking for, which allows them to release some human resources in the school so that they can have a physical and mental space to be able to think about what they need to do and how to do it. So this is a place where the teaching staff and innovation, or teacher training and innovation, can all happen in the same area, and that area is the school, obviously with all the connections that can be made. So connected to the research world, with the corporate world, with technology design. We live in a very rich environment from that perspective, and I think that we should try to find these synergies and promote them, because we can already do a lot. What we need to do is really share it, connect it, and allow the teachers to really take on the key role. And that role will be philosophical. Well, this is a group who have struggled because they don't have a quite often they don't have the space to develop, but there are brilliant professionals in this context who do wonderful things every day. Let me leave you with some recommended reading.